So Johnny Murphy, after one of Munster's greatest ever escapes, another miracle match, this time in France, 39 points to 31 winners against Clermont Auvergne at Stade Marcel Michelin. Can you, I suppose, just sum up what you saw over those 80 minutes, if you can?
Yeah, the stereotypical game of two halves, really. Clermont looked so dangerous in the first half. Every time they had the ball, they looked like they were potentially going to be able to score a try. I think Munster then just, they couldn't control, particularly, kickoff receipt, first kickoff of the game, they couldn't control the ball. Clermont scoring the corner, and all momentum was just with Clermont. And it looked like, at time, Munster were just clinging on for dear life. But a pivotal moment for me was about five or six, was probably about 2 or 3 minutes left in the first half, where Clermont had an opportunity to score again, and Munster held them out. That was massive for them. I think if they'd gone on another score, that would have been, they would have put themselves under probably too much pressure. But to go in at halftime, holding them out like that, and then they just changed tactics. They controlled the ball. They put the pressure back onto Clermont. Put them in their 22. Got them to exit, but exit on Munster's terms. And for me, the thing that I loved to see was the variance at line-out time. Clermont, they had a couple of really good training ground moves where led to the first try for Haley in the first half. Delande had a clear line break. And then in the second half, their scores come from that variety. They set up two driving mauls. They run one peel, and then they score. It was great to see, and they're putting a lot of work in on the training ground, and everyone knows their roles, and they're doing their job, and it was great to see.
How much credit does Jay Jehanran deserve? He's someone who, like, he would receive a lot of criticism down the years for his ability to deal in the pressure moments. Mm. And throughout the course of this game, like, Clermont had gone 28 points to 9 in front. And it was something you were commenting on maybe towards the end of the first half and into the early stages of the second half. How Munster were getting those penalty opportunities and just keeping the scoreboard ticking over. Yeah. And once they got to that stage where they were in it, and then when the kicks actually became pressure kicks, Hanrahan stepped up, and each one of them straight between the posts.
Yeah, I think, and he controlled the game very well. You have to remember that JJ's the one calling all these calls as well. So the variance in how you play is based on the calling structure of the 10. But, he'd won really good kick from far out right on the 15. Another one from inside his own half, hit the crossbar, goes over. But, Clermont's ill-discipline gives JJ the opportunity to keep Munster in the game. And it was the same last week. They were very ill-disciplined last week. This weekend, I think their penalty count was in the 20s. It's so important that when you get given those opportunities, that you take them. And the momentum shift then slowly starts to shift your way. Keep chipping away at those leads. And then when you get the opportunity for that killer punch, take it. And Munster did that today.
Another player who stood out, Josh Witcherly, playing his second European game, his first European start, in the single digits in terms of the amount of senior rugby he's played. On 75 minutes, he was still out there. He was one of Munster's highest tackle counts throughout the course of the game as well. And after that scrum we spoke about, where he was sent up into orbit by Rabah Slimani, came back and managed to win a couple of crucial scrum penalties as well.
Yeah, I think the resilience shown there is huge. And, obviously a lot of nerves going into up against a real wily old, front rower. And, I think that picture, he's going to see that picture a lot.
Particularly since they won.
Yeah, exactly.
They're going to be even more eager to show it to him.
I'd say it's probably on their WhatsApp group already. But to come through. And what I loved about it wasn't just scrum time. He grew into the game at scrum time, but it was his defensive efforts and his double efforts. He was responsible for two turnovers. Peter O'Mahony gets in over the ball once. He had a double action there. The tackle before that, he comes in over the top, gets a real positive action, drives someone back. And then the next phase, he's back in line, chop tackle. Peter O'Mahony gets over the ball. He had those positive actions the whole way through the game and never took a backward step, which for a young player, given what happened in the first scrum of the game, is massive. And he'll only grow from that experience And it puts him in a really good spot to move forward.
So that's two European wins from two. We're heading into another busy period now with Leinster coming up on Stephen's Day, and then another few rounds of Interpros, and you're into Heineken Champions Cup again. Munster, 9 wins from 9 now in all competitions. What's the potential of this Munster team? Because we're seeing so many good young players coming through over the last number of weeks as well, and someone we just spoke about, Witcherly, there as well. What do you see as the potential for this group?
Well, I think the most important thing is for them to grow on evenings like this, to experience what just happened, be behind, come out the other side of that and win. I think the possibilities for this Munster side are you know, they're really good in terms of where they can get to, particularly when all the injuries come back. You know, you're going to have a squad. This transition period, for the want of a better word, is giving those guys the opportunity. And when everyone is back fully fit, there's no problem now if James Cronin comes back in the future. There's no problem. Josh, you're in straight away. And what that does is it keeps all the other front rows, keeps Kilcoyne, you know, now there's 3 European standard loose head props because they're proven to a point, you know. And Josh is on his first start is went to a European cauldron that not very many people come away with, you know, with the credit that he has. It creates massive competition within the group. It builds a squad out past that greater number of 32, 33, 34, 35. And that's when you start winning stuff, because the injuries which are going to get come the end of the season don't necessarily matter like they have been over the last couple of years. And I think that's the biggest change for me over this last, you know, since probably COVID started for them.
And you would have been involved at Munster back when they probably had the last really, really good crop of young players to come through, when Conor Murray, when Peter O'Mahony were coming through, and even the tail end of that season when you won the Magners League, Danny Barnes even was coming in, making an impact. That was the last time we probably saw a really, really good group of Munster Academy players coming through and making their mark. What do you remember back from that time of the kind of things they were doing, the standards they were driving, and the things they were doing to put themselves into the team ahead of the more established players in the squad?
Well, I think, for instance, Peter O'Mahony was captain, you know, that World Cup year in 2011, you know, when the lads went down to Murray was a bolter. He wasn't in the initial 40 or 58 guys that weren't got letters that to put be on standby for the World Cup. He ended up being the starting 9 in 2011. While they were away, you know, even though the likes of Mikko and Dougie and those other guys were in that room, Pete was captain for that period of time. So they drove the standards. They accepted what had been before, but wanted to really drive things on themselves. And I think that's where it's respect for what's gone before, but knowing that now it's our turn to really try and push things on and grab things for it to be our time. That's what I saw back then. And those guys are now coming to the end, you know, the last 2 or 3, 4 years maybe for some of them. But, you know, they have an opportunity now to drive on with these young guys and hopefully get some medals in their back pocket.
And just finally, I know there's probably a bit of recency bias and we're a bit excited having just seen it. 19 points down against Clermont-Auvergne away from home in France. This has to surely rank up there with one of the great, great Munster wins.
Yeah, I think so. Particularly given when you look at the overall context of who was starting, you know, Combs at 6, Josh Witcherly. You look at the injury list that they have, you know, between, you know, Kilcoyne, you know, Cronin, you know, Joey Carberry, Andrew Conway. There's a long list of guys there that aren't available this weekend, and to do it in those circumstances is brilliant, and that is only a good thing for your belief, your culture, and something that you can really hang your hat on and drive forward to, hopefully, which is an opportunity at silverware for them at some stage this season.
Well, John, it's been a pleasure being on commentary with you today. Very happy Christmas to yourself.
Cheers, many happy returns.